nanoHUB-U, online instruction.
Hey everyone, welcome to lecture 3.5. Previously we talked about what are some tools for calculating Maxwell's equations in time, particularly MEEP. And now we're going to talk about what's one application of a finite difference time domain tool in photovoltaics. And so just to give you motivation for the problem, let me talk about improving light trapping in silicon photovoltaics, which I had alluded to briefly before. And so in this case, we may have some sort of like wafer-based silicon solar cell, which could consist of a thick wafer of silicon, which may have front texturing and maybe like 200 microns thick. And so when light comes in, it comes at an angle, potentially, and then it can be fully absorbed if it's a short enough wavelength, no problem. But if it's like a longer wavelength, you know, it takes a long time to be absorbed. That's why you have so much silicon. In a silicon thin film, on the other hand, it actually takes longer to absorb it than it has time to be absorbed. And so, in fact, most of the light at longer wavelengths just bounces out of the silicon thin film. And so, of course, this 100 times thinner, so it kind of makes sense that applies over a broad range of wavelengths. And so you lose all that energy, and the efficiency as a result is much lower. And so here, basically, the idea is we want to add new light trapping approaches, which may be like metasurfaces or photonic crystals and so on, that could actually take that light that's coming in and then waveguide it parallel to the system so it can't escape back out. And so it can be fully absorbed. Now, of course, many groups have done work on this. And so here are just a few examples showing work from Carsten Rockstall et al. And also Lacombe et al. Basically, taking very complex texture structures and then trying to calculate like the light trapping based on like realistic geometries that are being built in experiments, and then showing like what is the relative external quantum efficiency, and then kind of validating that model to show that there's pretty good match between the predictions and the experimental results. So that's basically these two curves here, and then the reflection also has a very good match, the red and kind of teal curves. And there is like a strong motivation to improve light trapping, not just for single crystal silicon solar cells, but also so-called tandem cells. Because particularly for tandem cells, then you find that the potential efficiency could be much higher than for just a single junction. And this is kind of illustrating the concept here. So if you have a lower band gap of 1.1 eV and a higher band gap of 1.72, that corresponds pretty well to the band gaps of crystalline silicon and amorphous silicon, respectively. And so this is kind of the geometry that you might have for light trapping, where you have some sort of encapsulant glass, basically indium doped tin oxide, and then amorphous silicon, and then a junction with crystalline silicon, and then silver. So you can actually extract current in a two-terminal configuration, which is just like a normal single junction solar cell, but potentially with efficiencies over 40%. Now, people have tried this, of course, to build these, but the efficiencies for tandems are typically on the order of 12.5%. And then if they go to triple junction, maybe like 13 or 14%. But there's still certainly a lot of room for improvement. And so here, we're just showing, like, if you're trying to simulate these sort of structures in some of the methods that we talked about in Unit 2, like rigorous Kappa wave analysis, then there are certain challenges, like the texturing height in this structure is very significant, and also the texture features are very non-trivial. So in order to accurately capture these kind of features in a periodic matrix approach would require tremendous amount of plane waves, and also the computational time to do the calculation would be enormous. And so it's very challenging to actually implement that with these kind of realistic textures. So actually, arguably, finite difference time domain is the better way to go, like from a computational perspective. And just to show you a few examples of what actual experimental treatments are applied to these microcrystalline silicon solar cells, you can see here one is sandblasting, gives you this sort of patterning here. It has very complex feature set. And then you have abrasion etching, which is a little more uniform, but certainly not exactly periodic. And then you have the bead coating method, where you would basically take silica beads that were submicron and then put those into a pattern. That's like kind of the most periodic of all, and has feature size on the order of 500 nanometer in width and depth. In the next lecture, we'll go into more details about how do you simulate these sort of structures.